they just cheat. That was shooting a shot. That was a war. You know, they started that. What I would advise would be to keep your head down at all costs. Korea has to be recognize that. If they don't try to keep on our good side, you could rupture that whole relationship. Now, yeah.
전 세계의 경제 전문가들을 만나보고 그들에게 질문을 던져보고 그들의 대답을 통해서 우리의 인사이트를 키워가는 시간 글로벌 머니톡 오늘도 중앙일보 강남규 기자와 함께 하겠습니다. 어서 오세요.
안녕하세요.
네,
강남규입니다.
오늘은 그동안 우리가 만났던 분들하고는 약간 직업이 좀 독특한 분인가요?
그렇죠.
장르가 좀 다른 분인가요?
예. 네. 미국의 그 IT 정보기술 정책의 의견을 이끌고 있는 오피니언 리더라고 할 수 있습니다. 미국의 정보기술 혁신재단 ITIF의 대표 로버트 애킨슨입니다. 애킨슨 박사의 전공은 도시계획 내지는 지역설계, 지역경제설계인데 네. 사실 오바마 바이든 시절에 오바마 행정부 시절에 미국의 의회와 행정부의 정보기술 정책의 방향과 그 다음에 구체적인 대안 특히 중국과 관련해서 어떤 정책을 써야 하는가에 대해 조언을 해줬던 멤버입니다.
대통령 비선 참모네요.
한마디로 말하면 민주당 인사. 그래서 요즘 이분의 목소리에 힘이 좀 들어가 있습니다.
네.
자기가 지지하는
트럼프 바이든 시대. 대통령하고도 좀 관계가 있는.
그렇죠. 부통령 시절부터 알고 지내고.
네.
그래서 오늘은 조 바이든 미국 대통령이 어떤 속셈으로 반도체 전쟁을 일으켰는가에 대해서 그의 속셈.
네.
그래서 사실은 어떤 중립적인 분석이라기보다는 미국의 이익이 뭔가,
네.
또 미국의 의도가 뭔가, 조 바이든의 속셈이 뭔가를 직설적으로 한번 들어 솔직하게 들어보죠. 우리 애둘러서 말한 전문가들의 말에
네.
지쳤을 우리 3%와 중앙일보 구독자들에게 직설적인 언어를 제가 인터뷰를 해봤던 인물들 가운데서 가장 직설적인 언어를 쓰는 사람입니다.
멀리 빙빙 돌려서 얘기하지 않고
그렇죠.
우리가 궁금한 게 많아요.
예.
도대체 미국은 앞으로 반도체라고 하는 인더스트리를 어떻게 하려고 하는 거냐, 속셈이 뭐냐.
예.
그리고 자꾸 우리 삼성전자 자꾸 백악관을 부르냐.
그렇죠.
원하는 게 뭐냐.
예.
좀 속 시원히 얘기를 해주면
네.
할 수 있는 건 해주고
한국의 국익이라든지 사실 저널리즘에서 국익이라는 말이 굉장히 낯설고 어쩌면 의미에서는 부담스러운 언어인데요.
네.
사실은 한국의 국익과 좀 다를 수는 있지만 조 바이든의 속셈이 뭔지를 좀 알 수 있는 기회?
기회가 될 것 같다.
예.
그래서 사실은 조 바이든 대통령을 제가 직접 인터뷰하려고 했습니다만
불행하게도 성장 안 돼서
예, 이 애킨슨 박사하고 하면 그게 내 말 내 뜻이다.
그렇죠.
라는 메시지를 간접적으로 전달도 안 해주시더군요. 답이 없어. 바빠 이분이.
그렇죠.
그래서 저희가 그냥 임의로
네.
로버트 애킨슨 박사를 인터뷰했습니다. 자, 그럼 바로 이제 인터뷰 시작할까요?
그렇죠.
네.
애킨슨 박사님, 사실 오늘 애킨슨 박사님한테서 어떤 뭐랄까 중립적이고 전문가적인 얘기를 듣고 싶어서 인터뷰를 요청한 게 아닙니다. 사실 그 조 바이든 미국 대통령의 속셈이 사실 궁금했습니다. 그래서 오늘 영어로는 딥스로트, 그 다음에 우리말로는
빨대.
우리 한국 기자들 말로는 빨대라고 간주를 하겠습니다. 오늘 뭐 속 시원하게 바이든 대통령의 속셈을 좀 말씀해 주시겠죠?
I will tell you that he and I are like this. We see each other all the time.
예, 저 감사합니다. 뭐 말씀해 주시겠다 그러니까 솔직하게 말씀해 주시겠다고 했으니까 기대를 품고 한번 질문을 시작하겠습니다. 자, 사실 반도체 제작은 설계, 여기서 말하는 반도체 설계가 아니고 디자인이 아니고 반도체 제작은 1960-70년대 미국이 사실상 포기했던 분야인데요. 어떻습니까? 왜? 무엇 때문에? 갑자기 미국이 반도체 제작에 뛰어든 것일까요? 조 바이든, 왜 조 바이든 대통령이 반도체 전쟁을 일으켰을까요?
China. Not South Korea. First of all, you have to understand this was pre-Biden. There was a bill called the CHIPS Act, which was a bipartisan Senate bill. Senator Chuck Schumer, who was the Senate Democratic leader, and then a number of prominent Republicans. So this was a bipartisan bill. And the view was that the US still leads in semiconductors in terms of US companies, But a lot of them are fabless. In other words, they will go to a place like TSMC in Taiwan. They'll design and sell the chips, but TSMC will make them, to use that as an example. So there's a concern that the US is falling behind in the ability to make semiconductors. Secondly, we follow quite closely what China's doing, where they're putting hundreds of billions of dollars, or over $100 billion into subsidizing their semiconductor companies, including basing it on stealing intellectual property from Korea, from Taiwan, from the US. So there's a, and then on top of all of that is the Taiwan question. It's just not clear whether China will respect Taiwan's autonomy. They are increasingly showing signs of saber rattling. It's a term meaning maybe we should go to war. Maybe we should take over Taiwan. And there's a real concern among US policymakers, particularly in the national security establishment, that if China were to take over Taiwan, then they take over TSMC. And we are now completely dependent, or largely dependent upon the Chinese for semiconductors. That's really what's behind this.
에킨슨 박사님, 중국이 대만을 무력으로 점령할 수 있다라고 우려를 하셨는데, 제 귀에는 사실 그 말씀이 소설처럼 들립니다.
What, in the sense of worrying about Taiwan?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's interesting you say that. Certainly, U.S. policymakers don't see that. I have met with Chinese officials for 20, 25 years, and they, whenever Taiwan comes up, they always say that Taiwan is a renegade province. It's part of the People's Republic of China, and that it should be rightfully returned to China. You can argue the opposite. You could argue, actually, that Taiwan is the legitimate government. they were the one that was, frankly, overthrown undemocratically. But leaving that aside, I think there's a lot of legitimacy to the fear that perhaps China will eventually want to use military force to take over Taiwan. I don't know whether they're going to do it or not. That's not my area of specialty, but I think it's the notion of better safe than sorry applies here. So the idea is we should have more semiconductor production here. I would add, by the way, the way those policies are being designed, a company like SK Hynix, for example, which is a major, obviously, semiconductor producer, a company like Samsung, they would be eligible for support if they put facilities in the US. This is not about a US company subsidy. Now, if you're maybe, I don't know, if you're worried about Korean workers, maybe, yeah, you might rather have that SK fab in Korea. I get that. But to be clear, it's not about saying we don't like SK or Samsung or TSMC. It's more, we would like these companies to have some production facilities in the US, and we're willing to subsidize that. That's the notion.
네, 조금 더 구체적인 질문을 좀 드려보죠. 언론에서는 이제 이것을 중국과 미국 사이의 반도체 전쟁이라고 표현을 하는데, 그렇다면 미국이 얻고자 하는 승리의 기준은 뭡니까? 즉, 미국에서 반도체를 좀 더 많이 생산하고 싶은 게 미국의 생각인 것 같은데, 구체적으로 미국의 반도체 수요의 몇 퍼센트 정도가 본토에서 생산되면 어느 정도 목표가 달성됐다고 간주할 수 있겠습니까?
Sure. Well, first of all, to be clear, we didn't start the war. China started the war. I'll give you a good example. The Chinese DRAM producer, memory, dynamic random access memory producer called Fujian Hinghua. They were given, I don't know how many billions and billions of dollars just to build a factory, build a giant DRAM facility, I think 64 meg chips. And they were using it based upon stolen American technology from a company called Micron, which is with SK and Samsung, the three big DRAM companies. That was shooting a shot. That was the war. You know, they started that. But the second thing is, what's the vision of the end of war? Well, my colleague Stephen Azell has written a number of semiconductor reports that are on our website. I think the US has something like 13, 14% of semiconductor production in the world is in the US. I think we'd like to see that number go up to at least 20%, maybe 25%. But we're not looking to go up to 50%. That's not the vision. We still see a world in which there's chip production in Israel, there's chip production in Singapore and South Korea, there's still chip production in Japan and Taiwan. So we're not looking, the goal of U.S. policymakers is not to dominate it all, but it is to build it back up a little bit. Because, you know, 25 years ago, we had a lot bigger share of the global market was being produced in the U.S. And one last thing on that, COVID has really, I think, made U.S. policymakers much more sensitive to the supply chain disruptions. For example, when China was saying, you know, we're not going to export certain types of equipment that you need. Now, maybe they had a legitimate reason for that. I'm not saying they didn't, but it was a wake-up call to U.S. policymakers to reassess supply chain vulnerability.
에킨슨 박사님, 사실 미국도 과거의 80년대에 일본을 상대로 그리고 영국이나 프랑스는 그 이전에 훨씬 이전에 기술 전쟁을 자기 경쟁국과 해본 적이 있습니다. 사실 그때마다 결과는 실패했고요. 어떻습니까? 이런 역사와 달리 이번에 미국이 반도체 전쟁에서 중국을 제압할 수 있을 거라고 생각하십니까? 어떻습니까?
Yeah, I think you have to differentiate a couple of things, though. You know, if you go back into history, back after the Korean War, when South Korea was much more with lower income, just still developing, the U.S. actually played an important role in helping Korea develop. We funded the Productivity Center of Korea and a number of other things. So we wanted Korea to be strong, partly because we wanted strong allies to confront the communists, both the North, but to be fair, as Korea grew more technologically advanced, it was seen as both maybe co-opetition, if you will, both Korea's an ally and we cooperate, but also a robust competitor. And Korea has great companies that now compete with U.S. companies. But I don't think we've ever really done anything in a serious way to hold back Korea's development. What I do think we do, for example, in the Japan wars, if you will, in the 80s, largely what we were pushing for was saying, you know, your market is not open to U.S. companies. And it really wasn't. What we were saying is, look, we don't mind you exporting to our market, but you should have your market open to us. I was on a panel today where I was talking about the difference between China and Korea. And my point was, when Korea developed, you actually licensed American technology. You went to American companies in the chip space, like Westinghouse, you signed a license, you paid for it, and then you trained your engineers in the US. You did everything you're supposed to do the right way. That's not what China's doing. China's doing some of that, but they're not licensing most technology. They're stealing it or they're forcing it. The subsidies are way outrageous. So I think that's the big difference. Where is China in regards to making chips? They're still significantly behind the leaders. They're still significantly behind South Korea, Taiwan, the US. It's a very hard industry. And it's a hard industry for two reasons. One, the technical sophistication of the industry is very, very hard. It's not like making high-speed locomotives or, you know, 5G equipment. 5G equipment is pretty easy to make, really. You just buy a bunch of the components and you stick them together. I'm oversimplifying. Chips, completely different. You actually have to make the chip. And IBM just came out with a new 2 nanometer chip and design. I think Samsung's down to 5, maybe 6, I don't know. China's a long way off from that. The other issue also is that the industry doesn't stand still. So Samsung is keeping progressing. Intel's progressing, although not as fast as they should, but they'll keep progressing. And so China, it's not like here's the finish line and China catches up. The finish line keeps going forward every year. And China has to run faster than Samsung or Intel to catch up. Having said that, the advantage they have, though, is an enormous checkbook, enormous subsidies. So it's hard to compete against a country like that when you're basing all of your, not all, but most of your R&D on your revenues. It's a lot harder to compete. So It's certainly possible China could catch up. I don't, there are experts out there who have a better sense of time, but I wouldn't say in the next 10 years they're going to catch up. It would be longer than that. The chip industry is a very diverse industry. There's lots of chips that aren't very sophisticated. In fact, one of the challenges now in the US is the chip shortage. The chip shortage isn't in the most sophisticated chips. It's in these more routinized chips, much bigger, I don't know, 30 nanometers that aren't super, they would go in a washing machine, let's say, as opposed to a cell phone. So I think China actually could do very well in that space because you don't really need to be at the cutting edge. You just need to be good enough and have low prices. So I could see China expanding into that space significantly. I don't think the US goes out of its way to keep down competitors. I think what we're historically have tried to do is have them play more fairly. It's really about raising us up. It's about getting our ability to be more innovative and more competitive. You know, frankly, just as Korea is doing, you have a semiconductor bill that I know the government's looking at. You're supporting advanced R&D in Korea, as you should. So Korea has very good technology policies, very sophisticated. Obviously, could be better. Everybody can be better. But that's what we're trying to do now is
경제사학자들이 기술에 대해서 이렇게 얘기를 하면 농담을 하거든요. 기술을 개발하거나 돈 주고 사거나 네. 아니면 훔치거나 다 똑같다. 이 말은 뭐냐면 특히 중국처럼 자국 내 거대한 시장을 가지고 있으면 예. 훔친 기술로 만든 제품을 미국에다 팔면 특허 소송에 걸리지 않습니까?
예.
중국 내에서 팔면은 어떻습니까? 중국 사법 시스템이 자국 기업에 판을 들어줄 가능성이 크겠죠. 그러다 보니까 중국은 사실은 훔쳐 쓰고 개발하고 훔쳐 쓰고 돈 주고 사다 쓸 수 있는 거대한 자국 시장을 가지고 있기 때문에 사실 무서운 존재이죠.
네.
미국이 그것 때문에 긴장하는 것 같기도 하고요.
나는 가치 투자자인데 기술적 분석까지 알아야 될까? 기술적 분석 좀 중요한 것 같긴 한데 배우기가 좀 어렵지 않을까? 2021년도 3프로TV 주식대학 여름학기 교보증권 박병창 부장이 쓴 매매의 기술 이 책에서는 직접 알려드리기 좀 어려웠던 실제 매매 상황을 강의 영상에 담았습니다. 가치 투자자라도 꼭 알아야 하는 가치 투자자일수록 꼭 알아야 되는 차트 해석법 자세한 사항은 페이지2 앱의 공지사항을 확인하세요. 네, 박사님. 그런데 말이죠. 삼성전자라는 반도체 회사는 중국에도 이미 공장을 갖고 있습니다. 그러면 미국의 계획 혹은 미국의 생각은 삼성전자가 중국에서 더 이상 반도체를 생산하지 말라는 쪽일까요? 그런 것까지도 의도를 하고 있습니까?
No, I don't. First of all, you have to differ. It's hard sometimes, obviously, for non-Americans to understand American politics, just like it's hard for me to understand Korean politics. I read, but I don't, you know, you're not on the inside, you don't quite. Obama was very much about trying to work with China, trying to convince China to be more playing by the rules. And I think there was a general recognition that that failed. Then you had Trump, which was so far on the other side, you know, very aggressive towards China, export controls, a whole set of things do that. And you know, I think in a lot of ways, well-intentioned because China, they just cheat. Let's be blunt. Biden is not Trump. And if you want to know, the big debate in the US is really about two things in this space. One is, should we export chips to China and should we import chips from China? Trump was like, no, we shouldn't do either of those. I don't believe Biden is going to be anywhere near as harsh. So I don't believe that Biden would say, oh, we can't buy chips, a Samsung phone if the chips were made at a factory in China. I don't think that is at all going to be the case. Now, what I do think is that they would say to Samsung or SK, we'd really like you to have a facility, more facilities in the US. I mean, Samsung has some facilities, I believe, in Texas. SK is building facilities here. That's really what Trump was, what Biden would like would be more of that. I don't see him pushing SK or Samsung to say, you know, you can't make things in China or else we're not going to buy from you. I don't see that under this administration.
백킨슨 박사님, 미국은 2차 세계대전 이후에 산업 정책을 거의 쓰지 않았습니다. 산업을 정부가 나서서 육성하지 않았다는 얘기죠. 그런데 이번에 반도체 전쟁을 통해서 미국은 엄청난 돈을 반도체 산업에 쏟아붓고 연구 개발할 예정입니다. 이 미국이 산업 정책을 쓴다는 것은 세계 최대 시장인 미국 시장에 대한 접근을 제한한다는 의미로 보일 수도 있는데 어떤가요?
There's two different flavors of industrial policy, if you will. One is let's protect our markets and punish our competitors. The second is imagine this is a sporting event, a soccer game or a volleyball game. I saw an article in the Washington Post about Korean women's volleyball. So if you're the Korean women's team, what do you want to do? You want to exercise, you want to practice, you want to make sure you're eating healthy foods. That's one way to win. The other way to win would be you could bribe the referee to call all the balls out of bounds. You could shoot little things at the opponents to make them distraction. So my point is the U.S. isn't doing the latter, it's doing the former. It's trying to build up our capabilities. And as I mentioned, not in a discriminatory way against non-Chinese foreign chip makers. So the other thing I think that's important to recognize is we have had an industrial policy at times, certainly in the 1800s, we had different policies, but even the principal policies we had were right after World War II, when we were facing the Soviet Union and the fear of what was called Sputnik, the Soviet satellite. In the 1960s, the United States government invested more money every year in scientific research and development than every other country in the world combined. All their businesses, all their governments. We didn't call that industrial policy, but it was. So why did we lead on semiconductors? Because nobody in their right mind was going to buy a semiconductor because they were so expensive. Well, the U.S. government bought them. The Air Force bought them for missiles, for fighter jets. So that helped companies like Fairchild Semiconductor and Intel. So we had that policy. And then in the 80s, when the Japanese challenge was serious, we put in place a whole explicit set of policies that people, unless you know, don't really know about or remember. So, for example, there's a program called Semitech, which was semiconductor technology. That's what it meant, Semitech. And it was a consortium of U.S. semiconductor makers with the Defense Department to do joint research and development. And that was all about the Japanese, because the Japanese were really challenging us on DRAMs at the time. So we did a whole set of policies like that in the 80s and beginning of the 90s. But then we went back to sleep. We're like, oh, yeah, we're number one. We've got Silicon Valley. So for really about 20 years, we've been asleep. What's happened now, though, is China has woken us up. There's a great phrase by I think it's Admiral Yamamoto in Japan, who was the head of the Japanese Navy. And he warned the military leaders. He said, don't attack the U.S. because you don't want to wake the sleeping giant. So they woke the sleeping giant, and we just built our military industrial base was so huge that it's inevitable we were going to beat the Japanese militarily because we just had so much. The same thing has happened now where the Chinese have risked waking the giant, if you will. There's now a bipartisan set of support, a lot of Republicans now who are more free market and a lot of Democrats who are concerned more about, say, you know, social policy and helping the poor people. All coming together now to say, wait a minute, we have to fight and compete with the Chinese. And so we have to build up our semiconductor industry. We have to expand research and development. We have to do all these things. So we'll see how it goes. It's not a done deal, as they say, but it is, I think, an important change in U.S. policy potentially.
에킨슨 박사가 아주 그 미국인들 기억에 생생한 얘기를 했는데 사실 그 진주만 습격을 했던 인물이 일본의 연합함대 사령관 야마모토 이소로쿠 제독입니다. 네. 사실 이 사람이 미국에서 유학을 했기 때문에 미국을 상대로 2차 세계대전을 확전하는 것을, 전쟁을 일으킨 것을 반대했던 인물입니다.
네.
그래서 이 사람의 일화, 잠자는 거인을 깨우지 말아야 된다 라는 말, 그런 말을 인용을 해서 중국이 잠자는 거인,
미국을 건드렸다
라고 말을 하는데, 사실은 이 표현은 역사를 아는 사람에게
미국이 얼마나 이 문제에 대해서 예민하게
이 문제 예민하고 그다음에
생각하는지를
심지어는 스푸트니크 쇼크도 언급을 했고요. 최근에 왜 미국이 2,500억 달러를 쏟아부으면서 반도체와 기타 IT 분야를 육성하겠다고 하는 의지를 보여주는 데뭐 가늠할 수 있는 데뭐
결국은 우리가 어떻게 대응을 해야 되느냐가 제일 궁금한 그렇죠. 것 같은데요.
한번 이 프로그램 한번 그
부분을 조금 질문을 좀 드려볼까요? 애킨슨 박사님, 혹시 박사님이 삼성의 이재용 부회장이라면 아니면 이재용 부회장이 박사님께 조언을 구한다면 뭐 이 가장 큰 고민은 그렇다면 미국과 중국 사이에서 삼성은 어떤 선택을 해야 하는가 그런 질문이겠죠. 혹시 거기에 대해서는 어떤 답을 좀 주실 수 있겠습니까?
What I would advise would be to keep your head down at all costs. You don't want to alienate the panda. You don't want to alienate the U.S. You know, eagle. You just want to try to just keep on doing your thing and keeping both of them satisfied. Now, at some point, maybe you can't do that. But I will say this, if a company like Samsung says, if the U.S. is dangling $5 billion to say, hey, Samsung, if you build a fab in the U.S., we'll give you $5 billion, and Samsung says no, they will have made a major mistake, in my opinion. They will have alienated not only sort of the U.S. government, but the rift between the U.S. and Korea overall will be in trouble, because right now, we see you as an ally, and we see you, frankly, we are your protectorate, you know, because we still are. We have troops there. We could walk away. We could save a lot of money tomorrow if we walked away. We don't want to do that, obviously, because we have commitments. But my point is that Korea has to recognize that. If they don't try to keep on our good side, you could rupture that whole relationship. Maybe 15 years from now, if they have to make a choice, I'd probably choose China. You know, it's in your backyard, it's close to you, they're going to be bigger than us. We may just decide we don't want to be a global power anymore. We may say, hey, it's too much work. And if we start going in that direction and really leaving the rest of the globe up to China, then you don't really have a lot of choice, do you? So I have a lot of respect for what Korea has done. It's really, in some way, you know, people talk about it as a miracle. It was a miracle. What you have done, and I follow Korea quite closely. I have an article, I have a column in Korea Times, really, and I enjoy when I come to Korea because I when I come to Seoul principally because I do learn a lot, so very interesting.
고개를 들지 말아.
예, 굉장히
이걸 뭐랄까 우리 일상 언어로 표현하면 뭐라 그럴까요?
뭐라고 표현해야 될까요? 좌고우면하지 말라는 뜻일까요?
그건 굉장히 포멀한 말인 것 같고요.
예.
한마디로 간보지 말라.
예. 닥치고 미국 따라와라는 뜻입니까?
예, 그렇죠.
아이고,
지금 사실 우리 구독자분들의 생각과 내지는 생각에 상당히 거슬리는 부분일 수도 있습니다.
미국 입장에서는 그렇게 이야기할 수밖에는 그렇죠. 없겠죠.
예.
없겠죠.
미국 입장 얘기를 오늘은 미국 입장 얘기를 듣는 자리니까.
저는 그래서 중립적인 입장으로서 조언을 좀 해주십사 했는데 끝까지
예.
끝까지 I'm American.
네. 애킨슨은 절대 그런 사람은 아닙니다.
네.
사실 오늘
어쩌면 또 그래서 좀 더 솔직한 미국의 입장을 들을 수도 있었네요.
예.
네.
그렇습니다. 애킨슨 박사님 인터뷰에 응해주셔서 감사합니다. 다음에 한국에 오시면 얼굴을 마주하고 미국의 또 조 바이든 대통령의 속셈을 좀 더 자세히 듣는 기회를 좀 가졌으면 좋겠습니다. 감사합니다.
네, 고맙습니다.
All right, thank you. Okay, take care.
외교적 수사나 신중한 표현보다는
네.
상당히 직설적인 표현으로 명확한 의견을 제시하네요.
예. 그렇죠. 미국의 의도와 중국의 의도 사실은 거의 다 알려졌고 또 애킨슨 박사의 말을 통해서
네.
좀 더 자세히 들을 수 있었는데 선택은 이제 한국과 한국의 반도체 산업 업계의 리더들의 선택이겠죠, 사실은.
그렇기도 하고 우리는 중국과 미국 간의 반도체 갈등을 전해 들으면서
네.
속셈들은 있겠지만
네.
대놓고 싸우는 건 아니지 않겠나 하고 예상을 했었는데
네.
오늘 이 한국의 저희가 한국의 매체니까
네.
한국의 매체와 공식 인터뷰를 하면서 미국 정부의 비선 참모가
네.
이런 노골적이고 직설적인 표현을 쓸 수 있다는 건
미군 철수 가능성까지 언급하면서요.
네. 이미 중국과는 한바탕 싸웠다는 얘기네요.
그렇죠.
예. 아무튼 우리는 양국의 분위기를 또 간접적으로 전해 들을 수도 있었고 미국의 생각을 전해 들을 수 있었습니다.
극단적인 미국의 목소리죠. 현실은 아마 중국도 저런 비슷한 생각을 하고 있을 겁니다. 그리고 중국도 우리에게 똑같은 어조로 중국 편 들으라고 분명히 말할 테고요.
네.
그렇기 때문에 양극단의 그 사이에서 현실은 그 중간쯤에 어디 세력 균형이 이루어지는 그 선 지점의 현실이 어떻게 펼쳐지겠죠, 앞으로.
고맙습니다. 또 강 기자님 덕분에 예. 또 재미있는
사실 3프로에서 제 그 프리미엄 스튜디오에 구독자 반응이 뜨거웠습니다. 아 정말 그 3프로의 위력.
네.
제가 그리고 구독자분들께 감사드리고요.
네. 다음번에도 중요한 인사들, 유명한 경제 전문가들 열심히 찾아서 여러분과 잘 연결시켜드리겠습니다. 그러실 거죠?
아 예. 네. 최선을 다해 보겠습니다.
고맙습니다.
감사합니다.
코로나19 백신 1차 누적 접종자가 오늘 오전에 1천만 명을 돌파했습니다.
9월까지 모두 2,300만 명이 접종을 끝내야 하는데
이 접종 속도는 더 빨라질 것으로 보입니다.
1920년대가 떠올려지는 지금의 모습, 코로나 이후의 시대, 우리는 어디에 투자를 해야 할까? 3프로TV 주식대학 여름학기
6월 말까지 50% 할인!
리서치명가 메리츠증권 이경수 사단의 최고 애널리스트들과 함께 필기하며 공부하는 하반기 투자 전략과 업종별 시장 전망. 여러분의 하반기 수익률을 책임질 총 24강의 투자 전략.
더 자세한 사항은 페이지 2 앱 공지사항을 확인하시고 6월 말까지 진행되는 50% 할인 혜택도 꼭 받아가십시오.